Please rise to welcome the class of 2021.
Wonderful to have everybody here gathered on the graduation lawn this morning. We really want to thank all of you for making the effort to be here, and to be a part of the graduation ceremony, and to honor our seniors for their time at Colorado Rocky Mountain School. They have been asked a lot. They've had to go to distance learning last spring. They had to prepare and apply to colleges in the midst of a pandemic, and they had to navigate the uncertainty of a calendar and shifts in program. The fact that CRMS was so successful this year is a credit to a good number of people, but today we get to thank our seniors for their leadership and commitment. When I considered what I would share with all of you this morning, I almost felt obligated to make the pandemic the focus. However, I've decided that it might be in the best interest of everyone to literally turn the page on that moment and to move forward. Commencement ceremonies mark the end of a school year, but as the word implies, they acknowledge the new beginning that will commence when we leave here today. It was Cervantes, author of Don Quixote, that advised that the road that we travel is better than the inn we stay at. After an experience such as the one that we have all been through, we would probably be forgiven to continue to dwell on the inn that stores all of what we have lost and missed out on. Cervantes, though, compels us to move on, to get on the road rather than be caught within a negative static loop. This notion of the road at my age appeals to me because I am sensitive to the challenge of moving on when I have reached certain goals that I have worked hard to attain. All this effort and attention goes into creating a space that is, quite frankly, inviting to remain in. The inn is secure, comfortable, a source of nourishment and a symbol of achievement. And getting back on the road can feel so daunting, so uncertain, and so unpredictable. And it often takes an act of courage to start moving again. Cervantes, in his wisdom, reminds us that the inn is just a place along the journey. It is not the end, it is not a stopping point, but a starting point. The real goodness in life is in the journey, and our striving and our desire to keep moving and progressing. Coaches have taken the road and inn allegory and applied it to practices and games. The road is where you develop your skills, develop yourself, and come together as a team in preparation for the games that will be played. I like this notion of the road and the inn for CRMS because all of our seniors, whether they have been here for 4 years or just one, whether it was a traditional wilderness orientation or this year's modified version of a COVID orientation, have all started their time here taking a literal path that has allowed them to explore the beautiful public lands that surround our campus. These trips have had the added value of not just external exploration, but an internal one as well. All of our students, when in the backcountry, face challenges and obstacles that reveal truths about themselves and teach them that they are far more resilient than what they may have previously imagined. These literal and metaphorical paths are opportunities for them to begin to establish a sense of responsibility and obligation, both to themselves and each other. And this is a critical lesson of the path. We find the most fulfillment when we are traveling and progressing towards goals that not only serve us, but remind us of our obligation to others. If there's one lesson the pandemic has taught us, is that we are all interconnected on a global scale. The actions and behaviors of people in one part of the world will impact the quality of one's life in another area. And understanding this obligation to ourselves and others is the opportunity that we have been given through this challenging year. And it is not limited to just a COVID virus. This generation of students will have opportunities to decide how best to regulate recent advances in science, such as gene editing, future development in technology, because self-driving cars are on the horizon. And they'll also face environmental degradation, seen in our air, water, and species loss. And the list goes on and on. And every choice that is made, every path that is taken, will have an impact on the lives of the people, not only regionally, but also on a global scale as we collectively advance forward. So finding solutions to these opportunities will require that today's seniors remain lifelong learners, that they remain curious and introspective and aware, and that they connect their learning to a path of purpose, well-being, and maintain a sense of responsibility. And I can't think of a better group of role models that have surrounded you during your time at Colorado Rocky Mountain School than the faculty and staff here. This year was a great example of a group of people who showed up and delivered a program despite the challenges with which we were presented. At the start of the year, the unknowns and uncertainties were significant, and yet I'm profoundly grateful for the commitment to the school on behalf of the faculty and staff. They adapted new teaching strategies and demonstrated an obligation beyond themselves to ensure that all of our students continue to receive a quality learning experience. And so on that note, please join me in thanking our faculty and staff for such being such wonderful teachers, advisors, dorm parents, coaches, and much, much more. It has become a tradition during my tenure that we recognize faculty and staff that have reached certain milestones in their professional lives at Colorado Rocky Mountain School. We tend to honor those that have been with us for 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, and then most recently I had to add 40 because of Jim Gaugh and Mark Clark. So those that reached the 10-year milestone this year are William Brown, Katie Hyman, and Bobby Rosati. since last year we didn't have an opportunity to gather in person for this ceremony, I do want to recognize those individuals that also reached these milestones in previous years, last year. And so at 15 years, we thank Nancy Drena this year. And Joe White achieved this milestone last year, so thank you. We have three individuals that reached the 20-year milestone all last year. Those individuals are Daryl Fuller, Eric Krimmer, and Amanda Leahy. And then the largest group, 25 years at Colorado Rocky Mountain School. Last year, it was K.O. Ogilvie. Thank you, K.O. And this year, it's Jen Ogilvie, Maria Olivas, and George Weber. And then finally, this year, 30 years at Colorado Rocky Mountain School, Marlon Rhodes. So those are incredible careers, and those individuals have really devoted their lives, their professional lives, to the health, well-being, and growth of all the students at Colorado Rocky Mountain School, and they have probably impacted, if not hundreds, thousands of students during their time here. So it's an incredible achievement, and we are so fortunate and so lucky to have people who are so committed to this learning environment. So it is our tradition that we have four speakers at this graduation ceremony, all who have been selected by the senior class. It will be two students and two faculty staff members. And we're going to start with our seniors speakers. And our first is Eleanor Hicks, who is from... I'm going to introduce Eleanor first, right? And just say that she's from from Aspen, Colorado. She was accepted to Santa Clara University. It's the oldest university in the state of California. She plans to go there to study environmental science, or maybe more generally the sciences itself. But before going, she is going to head on over to Barcelona and study there, and then take a trip down to Tanzania to do some community service work, and then head on over to Australia to learn a little bit more about the fashion industry. So please welcome Eleanor to the podium.
Thank you, Jeff. Welcome. Parents, grandparents, friends, faculty, and most importantly, the class of 2021. It is wonderful to be standing here in front of you today. Only a month ago, we didn't know what this day would look like. Yet here we are, together, celebrating this graduating class. Our senior year has been anything but normal. This perspective is not only mine, but how the whole world has been viewing the last 15 months. As soon as we began to realize that these COVID times were unusual, we began to ask the question, when will things be normal again? As there didn't appear to be an answer, I am forced to wonder, what exactly is normal? The Merriam-Webster Dictionary offers normal, an adjective, usual, conforming to the usual standard, type, or custom. I question this definition because I think normality is individually defined and relative to our unique experience. How we interact with the world is personal, so conforming to the usual standard is inherently contradictory. On this campus, I have learned all different scales of measurements that have helped me understand incomprehensible ideas. Apparent magnitude is a scale in which the brightness of a star is measured. The base value of a star's luminosity is 32.6 light years away, and all stars are measured off of this value. Temperature, sound, density, all have their own seemingly arbitrary but scientifically specific scales. But when contemplating normality, there is no starting value. A hallmark of the CRMS experience is a 10-day backpacking trip that greets every new student. Last September, we improvised with a makeshift wilderness in the blazing heat. The smoke from the Grizzly Creek wildfire made the campus look semi-apocalyptic. I remember leading a group of new students up Tick Ridge to shovel dirt and move rocks, a character-building task. The sun was a faded brown orb in the sky, lingering behind a wall of seemingly impermeable smoke. It was an auspicious start to the school year, and with the pandemic hitting its stride, I could only imagine that the world was coming to an end. We were figuring out how to constantly wear our masks. We sacrificed our environmental ethics and only used plastic in the bar fork to keep COVID at bay. We stayed in our dorm rooms and barely saw one another. We were all engaged in an unironic game of tag as we tried to keep up with the latest restrictions and constantly changing rules. We endured all of these things to preserve our ability to remain together, to learn, to play, and to be normal. When I reflect on my time at CRMS, I'm again confounded by this notion of normality. In geology, Cale Ogilvie coaxes us to various sites around the valley to explore a myriad of formations. Normal for geology, right? However, as a part of our evaluation, he encourages us to actually eat the rocks. He argues that the taste is a key component to the identification. I would say this is not very normal. A birthday celebration usually involves cake with candles. However, my dorm parent, Juanma, decided that we were going to celebrate by driving around the Carbondale roundabout 16 times for my dorm mate's birthday. After the last lap, none of us could sing happy birthday, let alone eat a slice of cake. This was definitely not a normal party. Throughout the year, students participate in various competitions in biking, climbing, skiing, swimming, etc. At the end of the year, the school hosts a dinner to celebrate those who have excelled in these Oystermeisters. However, instead of eating burgers or ribs, we have a lovely dinner of Rocky Mountain oysters. If you don't know what these are, ask the person next to you. But I can assure you that this meal is far from normal. I have learned that these varied and unusual experiences were intended to inspire confidence and create our own perspectives on the world around us. I've watched every member of this class achieve greatness. Passion and drive in what we do, kindness and compassion as we support one another. With this world defined by coronaviruses, climate change, economic inequity, and uncertain futures, do we want just normal people? Perhaps this is a better question than trying to define the term. We need a next generation of leaders who, in the face of adversity, rely on creativity and ingenuity to craft solutions. I am confident that each one of us in the class of 2021 has the ability to approach the world with this outlook. William Shakespeare once said, "Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them." We cannot always rely on the promise that we will be born great. However, this class has shown that it can confidently and completely respond to situations that require patience, perseverance, and profound humility. I challenge all of us to abandon this idea of returning to what is normal, and instead focus on what is possible, because the future will demand this of us. So I say, instead of trying to be normal, let's expand our abilities to be resilient, courageous, respectful, hardworking, compassionate, and kind. I cannot wait to see what each of us will achieve, and I'm sure that we will all go on to redefine the word normal. Thank you.
So our next speaker this morning is heading to Lewis and Clark College, just outside of Portland, Oregon, to study environmental engineering. He wants to take advantage of the Portland area for internships. So please welcome Zane Mullaly to the podium.
Are we good? Okay. All right. Just quick preface. My lips are a little dry, so let's be careful on the timing of the pictures. Good morning, my fellow classmates. We did it. Almost. As I present to you all my third attempt at a totally unique speech, I would like everyone to reflect on how fast these 4 years have flown by. Wow. Very cool. However, there are still obstacles between you and this beautiful finish line before us. You all have selected me, my voice, my thoughts, to be one of those obstacles. For a whole month, I've been racking my brain, desperately trying to find direction and purpose within the words that I write and am now speaking. Every morning of spring trip, I would set aside time to think on what to fill my precious 5 to 7 minutes of your lives with. The same ritual occurred every morning. Pour my coffee into a Kuhner's pinto bean can that I had been shamelessly using as a cup, warm my delicate and poorly circulated hands, analyze the sharp and sheet metal-esque qualities of that the lip of my bean can presented, push down the aforementioned barbed edge, and then finally enjoy a tender sip of the black hazelnut and citrus coffee. As I peppered my lips with hints of possible tetanus, I flattered my ego while thinking to myself, ah, black coffee from a tin cup. This is how the legendary and gritty cowboys lived. Immediately realizing the immense privilege that came behind the lie that I had just told myself triggered my thinking process. Gazing into the stunning valleys that surrounded our campsite, feeling the sublime, as the romantics would put it, ideas would fill my head. However, wilderness, trips, classes, inside jokes, late nights, and painful exams all pale in comparison to the connections that this school provides. And to talk in depth about just one of these things would be an injustice to our time here. Besides, I don't want you all to leave with a 5-minute stroll down memory lane. I want everyone to take something back from my words that will connect us. A connection that is stronger than those created by the years of repetition and proximity to each other. In the final moments of my last spring trip, I was also asked to bring something with me from my experience. To carry it from the desert, brush the sand off of, and implement into my life. The same brain that had just been rapid-firing insignificant thoughts about coffee and tetanus stopped and provided. It cleared away the surrounding canyons that had spent millions of years making the creatures below them bask in insignificance, and left me with a feeling so precious and rare, I could not help but dive into it. I wanted to see every day through a feeling of gratitude and thankfulness for the opportunities and experiences that I have been exposed to here. This past year has allowed me to realize that this school is unique in its ability to constantly provide things to be grateful for. Outside of our community, brutal discrimination, resource shortages, restrictions on expression, and more have plagued this year. Yet CRMS, by design, remains almost untouched compared to those around us. While others struggle to survive and live in fear, we are saved from the blinding and violent whirlwind of their reality. One that has been taking their breath away for longer than we have been alive, yet we remain protected and empowered. I have no idea how to stop our whirlwind, mostly because I am a part of it. So, I will maintain and express my gratitude until we figure out how to stop this thing that unjustly takes others' breath away. I am grateful our effort is invested in self-elevation rather than survival. I am grateful that when I shake, it is from laughter and sacred moments that you all have given me, rather than a painful tremble from hunger. A hunger not just for food, but for a greater sustenance that we routinely and carelessly rejoice in. I am grateful that we have been encouraged to share our thoughts and experiences here, and let those things evolve into a shield for our future difficulties. I am grateful for each one of you that has shaped who I am, and every inhale that I have been able to take here at CRMS. However, guilt is a relentless and constant shadow that can follow these moments of gratitude, and it is far too easy for me to ask terrible questions to myself. Why should I be given these opportunities when others are certainly more deserving? What if I lack the ability to apply all of myself in ways that justify this inequality? But my friends, we must not think like this. We have spent these past 4 years learning how to navigate these exact doubts. Though it does matter who should get access to opportunities, it is paramount to our success that we use them in every way possible. To dwell on the what ifs only furthers the divide between the privileged and the less privileged. Action, application, love, empathy, gratitude, these are what bring us together and bridge this gap. These are what CRMS has been teaching us throughout our time here. So, speaking to what I mentioned at the beginning of this speech about leaving here with a connection, I want us all to leave here connected by gratitude and an awareness of our situation. My lovely peers, my friends that I have laughed with, cried with, rejected, embraced, pushed around, hurt, supported, and every other action that can show how potently we have touched each other's lives, let us, in these final moments and beyond, be grateful. For while others fight to merely inhale, we, with reckless and beautiful innocence, breathe in the lilac air of CRMS. Thank you.
Eleanor, Zane, thank you so much. So now we welcome Bryn Peterson and Kao Ogilby playing Free Falling by Tom Petty. Right?
I apologize. And I'm going to be playing Free Falling by Tom Petty of the John Mayer recorded version. My favorite version. She's a good girl, loves her mama. Loves Jesus in America too. She's a good girl, crazy about Elvis. Loves horses and a boyfriend too. Free falling, falling, yeah. the good girls are at home with broken hearts, and I'm free. Free falling, falling, and I'm free.
So now it's time for our senior class awards. The award winners have been selected by the CRMS faculty, and the tribute to the award winner has been written by the award winner's advisor. First, the Academic Award. The Academic Excellence Award is conferred on a student whose academic performance during the year demonstrates remarkable consistency at the highest level of achievement. The intent of the award is to reward those who have rewarded us in the classroom, both students and faculty, who achieve on a level of excellence matched by the values of scholarship we hold dear, and who study with intensity, motivate themselves and others, and genuinely celebrate learning in all aspects to its fullest. This student, according to Matt Norton, has always been interested in the questions that don't have easy answers and has never shied away from asking them in class. We all benefit from this student's curiosity by being tasked to confront the complexities and nuances that are inherent to difficult questions. This student is unflinchingly supportive of others in academic discussion, values the input of everyone, and has a willingness to pull people off of the sidelines and into the conversation. Mark Clark, when talking about this student, opined, "Most notable to me is the level of attention the student pays to the work, with not just an intellectual understanding of what we are reading and discussing, but a full body experience of it. What a treat to have had this student in my class." Dan Pitts added, in Spanish, this student was always involved in the conversation and made the language genuine and real. This student made connections from the classroom to the greater world, celebrated learning, and enjoyed creating a fun learning environment for all of us. Jeremy Wolf emphasized how this student has been amazing this year in both physics and game design. You know that this student is focused, but rarely how much until this question after class. The question that digs deeper, that question that gets at some detail the rest of the class ignores, with a motivation that is not grade driven, but from truly wanting to understand. And finally, A.O. Forbes sums it all up when he speaks about how this student communicates through his writing, the impact it has had on him. I have been so humbled lately, he writes, with such clarity and with a sense of connection that reveals a profound commitment to come together. This year's recipient of the Senior Class Academic Award is Zane Mullaly. Congratulations, Zane. And now for the Community Award. The CRMS Community Award is the highest recognition the school community can bestow on a student. Those who receive the award embody the enduring values that have been at the core of the school since its beginning: respect, responsibility, and excellence. The award recognizes individuals for their willingness beyond their responsibility beyond themselves, and for their willingness to work for the benefit of all, and for the legacy through example that endures in the memories of everyone. This past year, this senior recipient of the Community Award has changed in ways so profound that it's both mystifying and inspiring. This person had made a deep impress on so many, so deeply, with their willingness to learn more about themselves. You've shown all of us courage in facing down fears and anxieties, the things we all deal with as humans in the modern world. We all deal with self-doubt, second-guessing, worrying about the world and how to approach it. It's not that this person figured out how to conquer these very real feelings that we all experience. Is that this person dives deep into them with a self-awareness and a vulnerability that is pure. This past year, this individual did not need encouragement to pursue their academic goals. They set them and took responsibility for reaching them. This past year, no one has had to remind this person of the reason behind rules and social norms that help a community like CRMS endure amidst this pandemic. You've shown through words and deeds that there's not only reason, but joy in selflessly supporting classmates, faculty, friends, and family in being part of something bigger than any one person. This past year, this person needed no coddling or reminders to do the right thing. They've instead stood up in class, in the backcountry, and in our community to lead, not by fiat, but by example. You've shown us all one way to understand servant leadership in action. In fact, if fault must be found in anything this past year, it's been this individual's procrastination around getting their bike fixed. We are all inspired by the way this person's soul shines now, and we cannot wait to see how you make your way in the world. Be it college or carpentry or both, it's easy to have faith that you will always be willing to listen to your heart, to question yourself, and to center yourself in mindfulness of what you and those around you need to engage the world with every breath you take. This year's winner of the Senior Class Community Award is Cooper Frazee. Congratulations, Cooper. Our faculty speakers for this afternoon are Matt Norton and Ryan Margot. Please welcome to the podium Matt Norton, head of our English department.
Here, the wind has done a number on my speech. That one. All right, we'll go with it. Thank you all. Again, welcome guests to the graduating class of 2021. In light of the circumstances, it's especially nice to see you all. You were the chosen ones who made it onto the rarefied guest list. You were the varsity squad, the grade A cuts, the creme de la creme, and you're also mostly their parents. Class of 2021, as a sophomore year English teacher for the vast majority of you, it's been a while since I asked you to memorize a Shakespearean monologue or prepare for and complete a final exam. Congratulations, you have finally exacted your revenge upon me by asking me to compose a thoughtful or at the very least not boring speech. Hopefully you can now see the wisdom in the old adage that revenge is a dish best served cold. You've waited 2 years to hand me the entree, and now you can enjoy watching me squirm as I deliver one final pedantic lecture from a lectern, no less, for the next 45 minutes. Of course, I'm mostly kidding. It is, in fact, a great honor to be asked to speak to you and your guests today. But truly, the greatest honor has been the ability to spend time with you in the classroom and elsewhere during your tenure here at CRMS. And despite what my mustache last year would have led you to believe, being entrusted by your families, my colleagues, and the Board of Trustees to educate you is not something I venture into lightly. With the lone exception of Jake, I wish you could have made interim happen, I've had each of you in class, on trip, in an interim, or on a team, and it's more than fair to say that I've taken up enough of your time at this school already. You're all beginning to twitch and shift like horses to the barn, so I'll make this succinct and hopefully worth one last while before you get that leather diploma. In the sophomore year, we read the famous Enlightenment-era satire, Candide. It's a Bildungs Roman, and thanks to Eliot's class, you all know that's just a fancy German word for coming-of-age novel. Here's a quick synopsis to bring everybody up to speed. The protagonist, Candide, a young aristocratic boy who's your age, is taught to believe everything in the world is for the best. He gets kicked out of his kingdom, and he begins to see the horrors and complexities that exist in the world at large. He travels around the Western Hemisphere and experiences the multiple natural disasters and sees the worst human offenses imaginable, from the annihilation of indigenous peoples to the practice of slavery. He winds up in Turkey, crestfallen and completely unconvinced that politics can solve the problems of humanity. In response to his loss of faith in all systems of religion and government, he decides that he and his closest friends must simply cultivate their garden. And thus a famous metaphor in the Western canon is born, cultivating one's garden. This has since been interpreted as withdrawing from the static of political and social debate, and instead attending to the immediate needs and wants of one's individual life and inner world. Okay, here's the crux. This is the point in the speech where I, the guy congratulating from graduating from high school, I either implore you to focus on your garden and cultivate the inner life that you want for yourself, or I suggest that this metaphor is bunk, and it fails to recognize that our gardens are, like Jeff explained, more connected to one another than ever before. And perhaps I extend the metaphor by talking about ecosystems and liken the internet and media to this metaphor to the various pollinators, birds and insects that germinate gardens separated by geography. Now, even though it's not pedagogically sound to give a pop quiz, we're gonna have one right now, okay? Raise your right hand if you think I'm going to talk about how it's more important to cultivate your own garden, and raise your left hand if you think I'm going to talk about the importance of not being a selfish, self-absorbed, narcissistic gardener. Look at that, faculty. We did it. We did it. That's right. Avoid being a narcissistic gardener. By most metrics, you all, we all, have too many advantages to squander on retreating into a solipsistic, selfish existence that portrays itself via posts on social media or overindulges in conspicuously egocentric lifestyles. A dirtbag climber, skier, boater, festival goer, biker, gamer, skater, van lifer, vlogger, and most careers that you find yourself daydreaming about when teachers like me really get going on our high horses, these are all wonderfully romantic and selfish endeavors. And when I say romantic, you may remember from my class, and Zane did, that the Romantics were a group of upper-class bourgeois academics whose response to the Industrial Revolution was to retreat from urban settings and ignore the experiences of oppressed middle and lower-class minorities. They had some pretty poems and stuff, but come on. Consider the following observation. There is not a long-lasting religious or spiritual tradition in the world which believes focusing on yourself more than others in your community is the highest goal. Let me say that again. There are no established religions or spiritual practices that value the exaltation of the self over service to the community. Even their solitary contemplative offshoots, monks, sages, yogis, and ascetics, teach that the entire purpose of investigating oneself is so that you may return to the marketplace to relieve the suffering of others. That is because fundamentally, selfishness is an unsustainable endeavor. We did not evolve into the creatures we are by being selfish. In fact, it's a well-known truth of evolutionary biology that genetic adaptations which express themselves as cooperative and altruistic have done the lion's share in keeping our species alive and thriving. Now, this speech is feeling a little preachy. But it isn't a condemnation of you or your generation. I've listened to your words today here up at the lectern. I've read them in class. I've heard you talk in class. I know you to be deeply concerned with the interrelated affairs of economic disparity, social justice, climate change. You understand that there is a significant population who don't even have the luxury to cultivate their metaphorical garden because they simply don't have time or material conditions to allow for it. I know that you want to have a hand in constructing a just and equitable future, or at the absolute least, avoid causing harm. And of course, I'm an English teacher after all. So tending to your garden, maintaining the equilibrium of your interior, paying attention to your mental and spiritual weather vanes, this is a necessary practice. And it is also an endeavor that is full of beauty and poetic surprise. And indeed, you will undoubtedly encounter bleak times in life when all you can do is to try to keep your garden viable. And when that's the case, nobody can fault you for attending to yourself. But I'm not telling you to ignore your garden. What I'm asking of you is to beware. Beware of the powerful allure of treating yourself, your garden, as the primary project of your life. Indulging in this project of the self without consideration for all of the other individuals in their gardens out there is ironically a road to personal and collective decrepitude. You don't need to look further than the self-help aisles of a bookstore. Oh, remember those? To see how prolific and tantalizing of a hobby the self can become. Scroll through Instagram, TikTok, SnapTalk, Twitter Book, and you see the propensity and appetite for indulging in and profiting off of our obsession with selves, all while ignoring or performatively acknowledging the real and material plights of others. I know this is a very boomer-esque hot take, and yes, I do have a side part. but I'm confident that you all have the media literacy and critical thinking skills to understand what I'm saying about whole segments of social media and consumerism as large. As I say this aloud, it sounds so simple. Don't be self-absorbed. What a revelation. Thanks, Matt. But it is hard. And I promise you, it will become even more difficult to navigate whether you are the one giving or the one taking. And as you start to narrow your interests and discover what technical field or career you might want to work in, you'll inevitably link your passions, your time, your life to the larger aims and goals of whichever company or institution that you hope to work for or create. These will be critical moral crossroads in your life. And here is where I make my second and final ask of you. When making these decisions, I ask that you engage. You truly and wholly engage in the moral calculus which determines whether your chosen vocation, the thing that you will likely spend the vast majority of your waking hours doing, is primarily serving your garden or our collective ecosystem. It is so simple, but it also isn't. It is what the Upanishads refer to as the razor's edge between perdition and salvation. And I trust you all with these weighty decisions, and I wish you more than luck. Congratulations.
Do I need to give him a sign or something like that? All right, our next speaker is Ryan Margo, head of maintenance. A handful of times on campus throughout the year, and they're not fun. I don't think they made them to be that way, but I always I didn't want to ever wear them, actually, even around the kids. I didn't want you guys to be afraid. In my mind, this is pretty scary. I always wanted you guys to feel safe on campus and not be afraid on campus. So, well, I always tried, if we had to do this, I always tried to duck in the back door or whatever it took to not show you. Oysters and pearls! Welcome to the greatest campus on earth, Colorado Rocky Mountain School. Thank you for being here. I am Ryan Margo, the Director of Buildings and Grounds. Today, we honor our superstar seniors. First off, I'm pretty lit to be thought of and chosen to address you today.
So,
thank you very much for that great, did I not use lit right? That's not. I put it out there. Really? It's a great gift, and thank you very much for that. I was thinking about what I would talk to you guys today. What does the head handyman on campus speak to graduates about? And I was cruising around in my whip. I'm so hip. I was cruising around in my whip, and I was thinking, and I was thinking about it, and something came up to me when I was cruising around in my whip. I thought of something that a mentor of mine once told me. When I was about your age, I was building houses in the summer months for cashish. And we were setting up one morning and he pulls out a Leatherman. He pulls this Leatherman out of his pocket, which, by the way, that was what was on your seat, so it all ties in. See how I am? So you also have a multi-tool to take with you when you leave today. Yeah. But he says to me, he pulls that Leatherman out and he says, you know, if you think about it, life is like a Leatherman. A multi-tool. They come in all shapes and sizes. They're designed with a handful of useful tools to help you accomplish day-to-day tasks. I was like, cool. Can we leave early so I can get to the beach and hang out with my friends or something? Which apparently prompted a head slap. And no, get to work. Now, this tool is something that in my day-to-day life that I've come to use quite a bit. If I need a screwdriver, it's right there. If I need a pair of pliers, it's right here on my hip. It's the right tool for the right job. A little over a year ago, we got a call. We closed the school down, and then we got this call that we were going to open up the school in person starting in August. I was like, okay, again, cool. Can we leave early today? No one had ever educated us, or no one had ever dealt with a pandemic, let alone what tool or tools to use for us to get through one. We had to learn. Once more, how to manage a private boarding school with kids coming from all over the country, possibly all over the world, in the middle of a pandemic. What tool do you use for that? That's something we had to learn. We had to learn together. We had to figure out what tools were necessary and available to us to make the campus safe, to open safely, to keep the campus safe all year round. What did that look like? What tools were necessary for teachers to create an environment for learning that was still going to be safe for our students? How do you serve food, keep a cafeteria open? And safe for mealtime. How do you do that? What tool do you use to keep a virus from spreading throughout campus? You use an electrostatic disinfectant machine that will keep any building 99.9% effective disinfected. Let it sit for 5 minutes, and then you can enter the room again after it's been settled. Thank you, Jeff, for the thumbs up on that one. Right? How do you do that? That was one of the tools that we actually came up with. We had to educate ourselves. We had to find those right tools. I mean, we all know that Leahy crushes CrossFit, but no one told him how to run a school during a pandemic. He had to find the right tool. He had to educate himself. We know Joe White can crunch some mad numbers. He's the master of cooking the books. But what he had to do was find the tool that would be best to keep us open, keep us safe, keep us employed. None of us knew what the heck we were doing when we came to running a school during a pandemic. We had to learn and educate ourselves. We had to find the right tools to get the job done. That's gonna be the same thing for you guys as you move forward out of the oyster bubble and move on into the world. For the last 4 years, or however long you've been here at CRMS, we've imposed a lot of rules on you. We asked you to sign an oyster oath. Keep your masks on, right? Follow the pandemic guidelines. Keep 6 feet apart, wash your hands. Use hand sanitizer. We told you when to eat, when to sleep, when to study, and when to play. I know I told you probably at least a half a dozen times to please not break stuff. But again, I always say that you are the yin to my yang, and if you don't bump and bruise the buildings and grounds, then I don't really have anything to do that day. So in a way, we're pretty tight. You keep me employed, so thank you. From here on out, it's on you. You're going to be faced with situations and challenges you've never faced before. Whether it's college life, outdoor adventures, personal relationships, family struggles, or wherever life takes you. You're going to have to be the one that finds that right tool now. There's no manual or handbook or even rules that will tell you how to handle yourself. All we can hope for is that we have provided you with some of those tools, those skills that allow you to think on your feet, think for yourself, to figure out how to fix what's broken or broken in your life, or better yet, how to build something great. And when you accomplish that, I look forward to being able to say, I knew you when. It'll be awesome. So here's the thing, you guys. We did it. We found the right tools to get a school open and get you through this last year of your school career, high school career. Awesome. You did it. Amazing, amazing. You've already overcome one of the biggest challenges, one of the biggest hardships we as a global community have ever had to face. And so that makes me feel that you're ready. You're ready to leave the oyster bubble and move on into the world and make and create great things. I hope that things get a bit easier for you. But just remember, put one foot in front of the other and always, always move forward. What you've accomplished graduating during this pandemic is something that you should be super proud of. I'm super proud of you. So congratulations to you. Thank you for thinking of me today. Thank you all for your time. Peace. I'm out.
All right, for our next performance, we welcome Olivia Ward and Jake Wallace. Thank you.
was finally open. The rain and wind stopped blowing, but you stuck out in the same old storm again. You let go of your umbrella, 'cause darling, I'm just trying to tell ya that there's always been a rainbow hanging over your head. Yeah, there's always been hanging over your head. Mm-hmm. It'll all be all right.
Okay, now it's time for the charge to the senior class. We have a tradition that an adult member of our community, faculty, staff, or administrator, is asked to give the charge to the senior class on the basis of their seniority at the school. This year's final words to the seniors will be delivered by the History Department Chair, Amanda Leahy.
Congratulations, seniors. Okay. Ooh, I might not have to wear my reading glasses. Here we go. So, think of the ways we interact with various spaces tucked within our daily lives, some of which, like the sound of spring peepers in the evenings, are distinct but often overlooked. I like the term liminal spaces, those in-between spaces, places, and feelings of transition. The Latin root limen, meaning threshold. Then there are the spaces that exist in a single day, the golden hour, which occurs shortly before sunrise or before sunset, when the low angle of the sun softens the edges of the earth and the world becomes ethereal. Or twilight, described as a holding together, a junction of two lights meeting. There's the witching hour, that early morning hour between 3 and 4 a.m., when certain folklore suggests the veil between life and death is thinnest. There are also the ways in which certain spaces can be transformed, tilted, suffused, swimming in an open body of water, the altered visual plane from horseback, the muffling of sound from snowpack. I imagine an ecology of spaces, each one with its own habitat, and we are the animal that gets to journey through them. These golden moments of delight, these incandescent evenings of symmetry, these dark hours of unrest. Even the concept of space can carry meaning. The writer Robert McFarlane defines the term trace fossil as the sign left in the rock record by the impress of life rather than life itself. It is a bracing of space by a vanished body in which absence serves as a sign. I think of this geological phenomena in the metaphorical sense as the residue of existence, the remnant contours of emotion that certain spaces can inspire in us, the trace imprint of memory. The writer Verlin Klinkenborg describes the act of noticing as letting yourself out into the world rather than siphoning the world into you. So if I were to have a charge, it is this. Notice the spaces around you, especially those folded within the creases of linear time, and inhabit them fully, like a fox in the wood or a bird in the sky. And if you find yourself on the precipice of a transition, poised between a known and unknown, you are in a liminal space, a space that is defined by both the unease of the moment and the promise that it holds. Congratulations, seniors.
Okay, now it's time for diplomas. Starting us off from Shanghai, China. Or starting us off from Shenzhen, China. Anderson Tsai. From Athens, Georgia, Mary Wilson Munnerlin Carter. From Boulder, Colorado, Noah Isaac Berman. From Basalt, Colorado, Zach Anton Fuhrer. From Palo Alto, California, Jacob Wallace. From the historic woody pasture of Carbondale, Colorado, and the Rocky Mountain School, Cassidy Sky Meyer. From Cresta Butte, Colorado, Seamus Swift Garvin. From Berkeley, California, Mac Muir Jeffries. From Carbondale, Colorado, Graham Charles Peach. From Mill Valley, California, Cooper Bradley Frazee. So Mike Z was not able to attend this graduation ceremony, nor was he able to be on campus this year, but we do want to recognize his diploma. So officially from Hengyang, China, Mingyi Zhi. From Aspen, Colorado, Eleanor Frances Hicks. I'm not sure if this location is real or aspirational. from Highlands Bowl, Aspen Highlands, Bryn Ryan Peterson. I just read what's written there. From Bethesda, Maryland, Charles Blaine Cope. Okay, from just south of the North Pasture, near the chicken coop, on the Colorado Rocky Mountain School campus, Greta B. Gavette. From Basalt, Colorado, Olivia Newport Ward. From Old Snowmass, Colorado, Madeline James Rogers. From Carbondale, Colorado, Radhika Marie Koss. Yeah. From Oakland, California, and also I think Carbondale, Colorado, Oliver Eggert Vaughn. From Carbondale, Colorado, Connor John Mullaly. From Carbondale, Colorado, Sydney Rose Pfeiffer Picard. From Carbondale, Colorado, Ryder Ronald Peach. From Carbondale, Colorado, Alice Ivy Amder. Ah. All right, from the headmaster house at the Colorado Rocky Mountain School, Finian John Leahy. From Silverton, Colorado, Molly Tisdall Wright. From Carbondale, Colorado, Alta Wren Kelly. From Old Snowmass, Colorado, Riley Liliana Puckett. From Bel Air, Texas, Kai Sol Rubenstein. From Dulce, New Mexico, Ida May. Okay, from Shanghai, China, Chen Li. From Carbondale, Colorado, Langdon James Erskine Dresser. Okay, this is the final diploma. And then once we're done with this, we will just ask the faculty to rise and give the seniors an opportunity to say goodbye, passing through them, and then they can join everybody else in the crowd, if that makes sense, just in terms of coordination. So we'll be exiting to the left, and then we'll come on over to the larger group. So finishing this graduation ceremony off, right, is from Carbondale, Colorado, Bodie Cooper Dallas.
So by the powers vested in me by the Board of Trustees at the Colorado Rocky Mountain School,
I now announce you class of 2021 graduated and alumni. Congratulations.